November 30th, 1954 was a bad day for Mrs. Ann Hodges of Sylacauga, Alabama. She was taking a nice nap on her couch when a grapefruit-sized rock crashed through the ceiling, busted the radio, and slammed right into her. Now, she survived, but was left with a heck of a bruise and the title of only known person to be hit by a meteorite. These things obviously don't happen often. Compared to death by space rock, you've got a better chance of getting struck by lightning while, I don't know, watching the Cubs win the World Series. Cubs win the World Series. Okay, maybe this is more serious than I thought. It only takes one look at the moon to realize the solar system is a violent place. But Earth's weather and tectonic activity have erased most of our planet's impact scars. Has that given us a false sense of safety? 200 years ago, people were just realizing that fossils buried in the Earth belong to creatures that don't exist anymore, that species could actually go extinct. And looking through their geologic obituaries, we know that around 66 million years ago, a lot of them went extinct at once, when a 10-kilometer-wide asteroid landed in what is today Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula. Although when I say landed, I really mean that a small mountain traveling 20 kilometers per second, glowing brighter than the sun, collided with enough force to instantly melt the crust, eject it out of the atmosphere, and shower the Earth with a literal fiery rain of death. Now, if a few kilometers wide doesn't sound that big, well, it isn't. Look at the size of that dino killer asteroid next to our planet. Can't see it? It's right here. At asteroid impact speeds, kinetic energy is cruel. Now, mass extinctions take millions of years to play out, but one very bad day and one very unlucky rock can be enough to set one off. The next big impact? It's a matter of when, not if. After the planets formed, the solar system was littered with a bunch of leftover rocky stuff. Anything bigger than 1 meter across we call an asteroid. Smaller bits from a meter down to a millionth of a meter across we call meteoroids. 40 to 100 tons of stuff enters Earth's atmosphere every day. Luckily, most of it's smaller than a grain of sand. When these small meteoroids burn up in Earth's atmosphere, they're called meteors, and any bit that makes it to Earth's surface before burning up becomes a meteorite, just like the rock that woke Ann Hodges up from her nap. But none of this little stuff is end of species material. We think the solar system is home to more than a million asteroids over a kilometer wide. Most of them live in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter, where they don't threaten Earth, which is nice if you remember that whole dead dinosaur fiery rain of death thing. But more than 10,000 asteroids of various sizes do cross Earth's orbit. So what are the chances that one of these will hit us? By studying craters on the moon, we can estimate how often different size impacts tend to happen. It's likely that a Hiroshima-level meteor or asteroid explosion happens once a year on Earth, but so much of the planet is uninhabited or covered in water that we just never see or hear them. 20-meter asteroids, the same size as the one that exploded over Russia in 2013, happen about twice a century, and usually break up before hitting Earth. 100-meter asteroids, big enough to destroy a city, and about twice the size of what created Arizona's Barringer Crater, happen about every 5,000 years. A 1 kilometer asteroid strikes Earth about every 500,000 years, and anything larger could put enough dust into Earth's atmosphere to cause long-term climate change. Nuclear winter asteroid edition. There's about 1,000 asteroids this size whose orbits cross ours. Estimating an asteroid's damage is difficult. The angle of impact, what it's made of, whether it strikes water or land, can all change the outcome. Take relative velocity. Two cars colliding head-on will impact with more energy than those same two cars in a rear-end collision. Earth is traveling around the sun at 30 kilometers a second, enough to move the entire width of our planet every 7 minutes. So depending on if an asteroid or meteoroid encounters Earth from the rear or head-on, it could enter the atmosphere anywhere from 11 to 72 kilometers per second. A big difference in the end, or not the end. If you want to see for yourself how these variables can change the impact, check out the Impact Earth Simulator. It's a cool web tool that lets you plug in different impact scenarios and pummel Earth to your heart's content without any danger of actual apocalypse. When it comes to mass extinction level asteroids, we don't have much data. The last time one hit Earth was 66 million years ago. Now, the bigger the asteroid, the more rare and the more infrequent the impact, but asteroids don't operate on a train schedule. Theoretically, an extinction level impact could happen at any moment. The good news is we've probably found more than 90% of the big asteroids near Earth. But the bad news is we haven't found the other 10%. Scientists have put all the known orbits into their big science machines, and there's no object that we know of with a serious chance of hitting Earth in the near future. But that doesn't mean one's not out there. But it also doesn't mean that one is out there. If we do find one headed our way, well, first, freaking out a little is okay, it's only natural, but then we'd have to take a deep breath and get back to science. We'd need to push that asteroid off course, just a tiny little bit. It really won't take much to avoid impact. There's no need to go all Bruce Willis on it. We could fire a rocket and hit it and change its speed just a little, but that might break one deadly asteroid into dozens of small deadly asteroids. My favorite idea is we could put a spacecraft right next to it and let the mutual gravity nudge it ever so slightly, like a gravity tugboat. We could even paint one side of an asteroid and change how many photons it absorbs or reflects. Use actual sunlight to nudge it off course. Of course, all these options depend on having a robust space program, something the dinosaurs didn't have. So unless we end up like them, go NASA. The asteroid that killed most of the dinosaurs made it possible for our lineage to arise. If another space rock pulls the plug on the human experiment, I'm sure another species will take our place. But I really don't want to turn the planet over to the cockroaches just yet. Instead, we could be the first species that's ever had a say in their own future. The first species that could make an impact by avoiding an impact. Stay curious and sleep tight. You might notice I didn't mention comets. Lots of comets cross Earth's orbit, and even though they're made of ice and dirt and frozen gas, they are big enough to end life on Earth if one hit us. Asteroids don't make me that nervous, but comets make me nervous. They live way out near the edge of the solar system until something nudges them towards the sun without warning. They have unpredictable orbits, they're hard to see, and they move faster than asteroids. So yeah, comets. There's your next disaster movie, Michael Bay. Anyway, if you've got ideas on how to stop those space rocks or space ice cubes from destroying humanity, let me know down in the comments. I mean, comments.